you have a comment on Mr. Porter?
Thanks, guys.
Well, we wish him well. He worked very hard. I found out about it recently, and I was surprised by it. But we certainly wish him well. It's a obviously tough time for him. He did a very good job when he was in the White House. And we hope he has a wonderful career, and hopefully he will have a great career ahead of him. But it was very sad when we heard about it, and certainly he's also very sad. Now, he also, as you probably know, he says he's innocent. And I think you have to remember that. He said very strongly yesterday that he's innocent. So you'll have to talk to him about that. But we absolutely wish him well. Did a very good job while he was at the White House. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. You can see the president. Some more questions are being shouted, but reporters are being escorted out of the Oval Office. I'm going to get back to Caitlin in a moment, but let's get some analysis of what we just heard. CNN political analyst David Gregory is with us, our chief political correspondent, Dana Bash. Dana, president was pretty enthusiastic in praising this individual who has now been kicked out of the White House.
Look, I don't know why I'm surprised, because I shouldn't be surprised, because particularly with issues like this, accusations on a personal level, the president tends to rally around the person being accused, because, and he has told many a friend this, that because he has felt like he has been falsely accused. Having said that, the fact that he did not mention one word, one syllable about these two women, plus apparently an ex-girlfriend, who, particularly the ex-wives, who are talking in great detail about abuse, physical, verbal abuse, is outrageous. I mean, I'm sorry, it just is. It just is. And it is tone deaf to the times. It is tone deaf to the situation that he has had, which is a person who has been in the closest proximity possible to this man, alleged to have done some pretty horrible things. And we've seen the pictures, but more importantly, we have heard from one of his ex-wives, both of them, but particularly one to CNN, about the details of the allegations of physical abuse. And to not even have a nod to that, and instead just profusely, effusively praise the work that Porter did, is just, it's sad.
Yeah, the president went out of his way to point out, David, that Porter says he's innocent. We absolutely wish him well. The president said he was surprised by all of this. He worked very hard, only found out about it recently. Obviously a very tough time for Rob Porter.
Right.
That's what the president said.
Right. And, you know, others who Porter has worked for, like Orrin Hatch on the Hill, has talked about how awful these allegations are, what a sad time it is for everybody involved. The president of the United States didn't even talk about everybody being involved, only Porter, as Dana says. I agree. I mean, it's outrageous. It is part of a pattern about how this White House and how Republicans rallying around this president have come to the aid of anyone accused of sexual misconduct or abuse. And not thought about those who are on the other end of it. The other layer to this is who knew what when, the core competence of the White House, why you have someone in the chief of staff, a retired Marine John Kelly, who comes from a world of order and accountability and no BS, and now we're being told that he was somewhat aware of these allegations. They've got a real problem that goes to core competence, that goes to truth-telling, and that goes to managing a situation that is volatile when you have someone without a security clearance who's got that close access to the president. So, you know, look, this is another case of where this White House is underprepared and not up for the job. And they're going to have to deal with the fallout of this.
Or even more nefarious, it not just about not being prepared or not up for it,
worse,
like actively
right.
having their heads in the
right.
sand,
right.
Which is even more troubling.
Right. And clearly, you know, they're parsing words, saying that the White House Chief of Staff John Kelly was not fully aware, but for months he was aware of these allegations by the ex-wives. He was aware of the fact that for more than a year, the White House Staff Secretary, which is a critically important job, was denied security, permanent full-time security clearances by the FBI because there were serious problems in his background.
Look, the way that the White House team is describing it is so painfully, painstakingly careful because they don't want to divulge. Maybe they don't know all the facts. Maybe Raj Shah, for example, doesn't, or Sarah Sanders in the press shop, they don't know all the facts of what John Kelly knew. That is totally possible. But we first reported the day that all of this broke, the day that Rob Porter resigned earlier this week, or was fired, that the White House chief of staff had at least an inkling about it, probably more than that, in the fall. And when I say it, I'm talking about domestic abuse.
And the White House counsel, the top lawyer of the White House, Don McGahn, he also had been briefed by the FBI.
Right, and there's more than one woman, two ex-wives, there's now a girlfriend who's contacted. There's an FBI process, there's a background check process. So I think anybody who would look at this would say it's appropriate to have a process and a fair process. But that's what the government does in a background check. And when you have these kinds of explosive allegations, you need to run them down instead of, as Dana said, put your head in the sand. Or, and the Times has reported on the fact that General Kelly has been a character witness in these kinds of cases before. And maybe he's got a blind spot around all of this. But what we don't know from him is the full truth, the full story, and it's his job. And, you know, he's got a lot on his plate. He's become increasingly controversial. And again, we get, people can make their own judgment about it, but we get more insight into the chaotic nature of how this president is running the West Wing, because it's a bazaar of information over there, of people trading information about, oh, so-and-so's talking to Reince Priebus, the former chief of staff. Oh, the president's thinking about replacements. There is no order. It is just a free-for-all over there. And in the middle, by the way, of a very sensitive time in our country and on the world stage.
Domestic issues, national security issues. But listen to Jenny Willoughby, the ex-wife, mm-hmm. who spoke to our own Anderson Cooper last night. Listen to this.
Mm-hmm. Knowing Rob the way that I do, he probably is able to, even if his clearance hadn't gone through and they knew that it was because of problems in his marriage, I think he was probably able to spin it in such a way that it was minimized, that it was downplayed. And I generally believe that Chief of Staff Kelly thought that it was lesser than it was. And seeing those photographs, I wish that my interview would have been enough, but seeing those photographs sort of solidified that no, this is in fact an issue.
Rob Porter's now in a relationship with the White House Press Secretary Hope Hicks. Do you think he's changed?
I don't think he's changed.
Does that worry you?
It worries me for a lot of reasons. I mean, it definitely worries me because, if I'm being frank with you, if he hasn't already been abusive with Hope, he will. And particularly now that he's under a lot of stress and scrutiny, that's when the behaviors come out. And if he hasn't already, he will.
Hope Hicks is the 29-year-old White House communications director, who has a very significant job, but she's had a romantic relationship mm-hmm. with Rob Porter.
And listen, I've had people say to me, oh, you know, you're being naive if you believe this. But others have suggested to me that part of the reason why somehow, some way, this was pushed out was to be protective of Hope. People who knew that this was a possibility and were concerned about Hope because she is well-liked inside the White House. I just want to also say that we're talking about really big issues of national security and about how a president should act, but we're also talking about a workplace issue that we've been talking about now for months and months and months. And the White House is now a workplace, according to people I talk to, where people are very upset at, obviously, not just that Rob Porter has these allegations against him, but most importantly, that their boss, the chief of staff, apparently knew about this, had some indication about it, didn't do anything. But even more importantly, now that he does have all the information, put out a memo to staff yesterday that had no accountability, no, I should have handled this differently, no, had I known differently, I would have done it differently. Right. None of that accountability, and that is a really
and
big
she
problem.
Did make a, but I've forgotten her name, who just
Jenny Willoughby.
Yeah, I mean, she does make a good point that perhaps General Kelly knew about this at some level, allegations, and then seeing the photos realized, whoa, I maybe made a presumption here that was wrong. That's a fair point, and it's coming from her. But again, I go back to process. You know, if you have a background check process that is holding up his security clearance in a workplace that happens to be the West Wing, you know, you're going to have to get to the bottom of this. This is a these are serious allegations. And then it's complicated by, you know, Hope Hicks apparently being, you know, dating him and then being involved in deliberations about whether he should resign or be fired and then being involved in drafting of the statement. That was is so inappropriate. And again, it's just part of a broader problem in the West Wing.